So are we talking about the operating at scale with Elasticsearch? What's the big deal about it, right? You can just download Elasticsearch in your local and then you start it. What's the big deal about it? The problem is, every problem you face will come only in production. Not just for Elasticsearch, for any application you mean. The same case here. We have faced many problems which you cannot even imagine it can exist. A little bit introduction about myself. I'm Jeeva, I'm from PayPal. And I've been working with Elasticsearch for like 3.5 years. And our team built the search platform, which is powered by Elasticsearch across PayPal. And we serve like more than 20 billion requests every day with more than 100 million searches every day over petabytes of data, not just terabytes, petabytes of data. And we have a large customer base, I mean internal PayPal customers, over more than 40 customers we have. That's about it. So I organized my session into three different things. First, to give the introduction of basics of Elasticsearch, and then the challenges which we face, and then I will come to the resilience aspect where in our application which handles the billions of data as I mentioned. So how does the data is organized in Elasticsearch? That comes the basics. So the index is the main data unit of Elasticsearch. If you want to correlate it, you can correlate it with a table in database or a collection in Mongo. It's similar to that. So if you have a single index, then you need to scale it. So you need to split the index into multiple shards. And the multiple shards will be residing on different nodes. Each will be backed by its own disk. Together, they form the cluster. And if you see, if the node 1 goes down, then the data is lost, part of data is lost. In order to cater that, Elasticsearch has inbuilt replication mechanism where every request you give will be replicated into other node like this. So if node 1 goes down here, the shard 0 will be there in the node 2 as well. So you won't have problem with that. So next thing I would talk about is routing. This is when I insert a document into Elasticsearch, what happens, right? I will just demonstrate that. Let's say I have node 1 and node 2, and I try to insert a document A. This is a sample document. You will be inserting with a particular ID. So what Elasticsearch does is, it will use a routing algorithm of its own, which will use the ID, and then it will decide which node it needs, which shard it needs to go. So in this case, it decides that the document A needs to go to shard 1. But shard 1, we have a replica and primary, but Elasticsearch always writes to primary first, and then it replicates to the replica. This is how it works. It will write, the writing we call in Elasticsearch as index. So we index the document in primary, and then we replicate the same in replica, and then we send the response back to the user. This is how the routing works. Now I will come to the, as I have said, the context a little bit. Now I come to the challenges which we faced and the learnings which we have. So before going to this, I will tell you a little story. There was a businessman and he had two associates. Let's call associate 1 and 2. And the businessman promoted associate 2. The associate 1 asked the businessman, "Why did you promote him and not me?" He wanted to demonstrate with an example. He asked the associate to go to the fruit shop and then he asked for the price of apple. He went there, asked for the price of apple and came back. The same he did for orange and some other things. It took like some minutes to do the same thing. Then he asked called the other associate and asked for the same. He asked for the price of apple. He went there, he asked for price of apple, orange and other stuffs and where they are from, all the details. What I'm trying to say here is, the more the round trips are, the more time it will take. So if you insert a document as a single request instead of multiple single requests, I mean with a bulk request, it is always better. When we started off with, we tried to do with a single insertion. Every request will have only one record. When we did that, it was awfully slow. Like we were able to handle like 5,000 requests per second, which is not going to scale with our scale. So after we did this bulk insert, we were able to see the performance improvement of like 10x. 10x is a lot. So from 5,000, we were able to handle 45,000 without any tuning in Elasticsearch. With the further tuning, we are able to scale right now with 200k per second. But the cluster is big though. And the second aspect is the routing. As I mentioned, Elasticsearch uses the ID to route the request to different shards. It also has a routing facility where you can tell an ID to route to a particular shard. So we had a use case where we have to scale like crazy, push like 6 million per minute. And the document size is also high, like 3 to 4KB. We were not able to scale much because of even with the bulk request. What we did was we created a single route ID for the entire record, entire bulk request. For a thousand, let's say for if a bulk request is having 1,000 records, we set the same routing ID for all of them. What it does is it will send, let's say if we don't have the routing, what happens? I will tell you. If we don't have the routing and if we have a bulk request with 1,000 records, what happens is it will, node one will receive that as I explained before. Yeah, and then it will send all the 1,000 records to 1,000 different shards, and then it will be replicated to 1,000 different shards again, and then send the response back. There's like lot of round trip between Elasticsearch itself. So routing is always makes it efficient. As there are no round trips here, all the 1,000 records will be returned to one shard, and then it will be replicated to other shard, and then it will send, response will be sent back to the user. So this is a lot faster. We were able to scale till 6.3 million consistently without any issues. Yes. We will give a route ID. We calculate that based on per previous experience, or Elasticsearch uses a hashing algorithm to calculate particular where it needs to route to. So we do some experimentation before doing that. And the mysterious search timeouts. We recently had this issue like a month back where the problem was Elasticsearch started scaling up. Like we started getting more and more documents and the search also started increasing. And we started facing more and more timeouts. We did not know what is causing the problem. We tried to do some things and which made it more worse. Like the error rates have come to 50%. Out of 100 records, 50 records will fail because of the timeouts. That's crazy. And then we dug deeper and deeper, and then we figured out that the machines which are running Elasticsearch are having more and more page faults. You cannot even imagine page faults can be the issue for this. We, with the help of Elastic team, we changed the map, the file system type from default to mapfs. Once we did that, the 50% of failure has reduced to 0.3%. That's a lot. That's one thing. And the second thing is query optimization. When we looked into the query, there were if we execute the query in a certain order, it will be a lot faster than the other. But in Elasticsearch blog, one of the blog, they have written that after 2.x version, they have fixed the issue. Like you can give the query in any order, it will execute it in a correct order. But it was not happening. We had to change the order to fix the issue. It, before fixing the issue, before fixing the order, it was more than 1 second. It took more than 1 second to execute a query. After fixing this, it was taking like 45 milliseconds, which is a lot of improvement. And as you all know, ignorance is bliss, right? But ignorance with power, it's a disaster. You give a monkey control to a nuclear missile, what does it do? It does just keep on clicking. It doesn't know what's the impact, so it will keep on clicking. So that is the same case which happened to us. Our users does not know how Elasticsearch operates, so they try to give expensive query. Expensive as in, I'll give you an example. Let's say you try to do group by, on a unique ID field. What happens? It tries to load everything into memory and then it will just blow. That's what happened, and it has happened multiple times. And Elasticsearch had a lot of expensive queries, not just the group by and unique ID. They have nested aggregations where it can fail as well. So what we did is, we created a gatekeeper between Elasticsearch and the application Kibana. So Kibana is, and Grafana are basically visualization tools. We built an application gatekeeper, which what it does is, it has a rule engine, which will check the rules. And then if the query matches the rule, it will just fail it instead of sending it to Elasticsearch. Success rate based on this. So what we did was like when cluster gets blown up, we will take that query and then we will put it as a part of rule. But what our plan is like to use ML to say detect the issue and then fix it automatically. What do you guys think of this diagram? Resilience, right? So even in the barren land, it's able to cope up. This is resiliency. What is resiliency? Resiliency is basically to staying responsive even there is failures. There are different ways to achieve it in any system, not just Elasticsearch. This is basically on the application we built on top of Elasticsearch, where we ingest billions of documents every day. So we have multiple ways to achieve it. One is timeouts. Without timeouts, what happens, I would say? If you make a connection and if it's not responding at all, and if you try to make connection again and again, your resources will be exhausted. So that's where the timeouts come into picture, and then the retries. So they are supposed to be there for any system, not just for our application with Elasticsearch. And then back pressure, I will talk about it a little later. This is related to reactive systems. And the last one is circuit breaker. So basically, circuit breaker is similar to the fuses in electronics. What happens when a high voltage comes into a fuse? It will just blow. You have to replace it. The same case here. When more and more failure comes, the circuit will open. And after a certain time, it will close and then it will check if it works or not. So before I explain about back pressure, I will tell about reactive streams first. I will tell about streams first. What is a stream? Stream is basically, let's say a river. River is also a stream. It has an originating point and it has an end point. Originating point would be a mountain and end point would be this sea, right? And there will be multiple villages or towns in between. It will go through all the way. The same thing, reactive streams are similar to that. The main difference is reactive streams has back pressure. In a river, if more and more water comes, you cannot stop it. It will anyways go to sea. That's not the case with the softer stream. We can control. Where the sink, the sea can control how much data I want. So this is a part of our application where we consume from Kafka source. And then we transform the data. Once we transform it, we will bulkize it. I explained about why we need to bulkize before. Bulkizing happens based on two things. One is based on time and then the number of requests. If number of requests exceeds n, or if the timer triggers, it will send the request to the next layer, which is Elasticsearch client. Elasticsearch client will send the request to Elasticsearch and then get the response back. The last one is sync. The sync has circuit breaker. I will explain about how the back pressure works in this case. So as I mentioned, the sync controls the demand. So sync send a demand to the next layer, which is Elasticsearch client. It asks for a demand and then it goes all the way to source. And then the source start pushing the data if it has, or it will pull from Kafka. Once that is done, if you see, once the push is done, the demand is getting reduced, right? Okay, once it goes to the bulkizer, if the number of requests does not exceed the amount it's supposed to, or the timer did not trigger, it will ask for a demand again. And then it will send the request back again. Once the number of requests exceeds particular thing, or the time it triggered, the request go to the ES client. And it will get the response from ES client and then it will push to sync. Now the sync will check if the request has failed or not. As it's a bulk request, there will be multiple records. It will check if the request has failed or not. If it fails, it won't ask for demand till that particular time. Once the timer triggers, it will ask for demand again. So this is how we built a resiliency with a circuit breaker and back pressure, both of them in place in our system. And to summarize, while you are looking at it, the two main key takeaways I would say from this session is the gatekeeper, which I mentioned. If you don't put a layer between the users and the underlying system, not just for Elasticsearch, your system will crash. They don't know what they do, so they will keep on clicking it. You will make the system more worse. We have had downtime like 2 or 3 days, days, not hours, because of just this issue before building this gatekeeper. And the second thing would be resiliency. So if this underlying system fails, and if you keep on sending a request to the underlying system, what happens? It will fail again and again, and then it will make the situation more worse. We do not want to have this. So any system need to be resilient, not just Elasticsearch or the application on top of Elasticsearch. And most of the things I covered are applicable not just for Elasticsearch, for any database for that matter. And QA. We have multiple clusters, not just a single cluster, and we have data ranging from, let's say, GBs to like 300 TBs. It's not the same single cluster. Data to RAM ratio as in for a single node you are asking?
No. So generally
Elasticsearch people suggest that using have data to RAM ratio at 1:24. So for every 24 data, just 1 GB of RAM. As our clusters are very massive, we cannot do that. The data is too huge. So we do not follow that particular process. It's not specific or deterministic. It will be different for different use cases. Yes.
Hi. Yeah, please go
ahead.
Yes.
Yes. So the sync does not ask for the next demand.
Yes.
But still it does not solve the problem of how to handle the error. I just wanted to understand.
So basically, right, so basically what we do is we will push the data again to another Kafka queue and then we consume it. By that way, we handle the errors as well. If it is a handleable error, we will consume it later and then we will push it. Else, we will just fail because it cannot be handled. I did not mention here because it will make the graph more worse. Yeah. Yeah, right. And okay, I did not talk about that. So we use Akka streams, which is a reactive stream. And we use a framework called Cubes, which is open source by PayPal, for bootstrapping the whole application and productionizing the application. Akka streams is basically low latency streaming. There are many cases, not just single. So if you want, we had a use case like they had to traverse the entire data over, let's say, 200 TB. They want to get a, they want to search for account number across 3 years of data, and they want to get all of them at once. So we faced a lot of issues because of that, and then we used the routing for account level. But the problem which we will have there is it will skew the sort size. Because some of the accounts account will have more data, more transactions compared to others.
Hi.
While you go through this, you can just look into what are the use cases we have. Yes, come to see.
Hi, a great talk. So we also run Elastic Cluster. I currently do 1 million documents per second. We ran into a lot of problems, same as you, and we did a lot of things exactly like you did. So a couple of things I wanted to ask was, did you kind of build a monitoring system to understand what the issue
yes.
was? Because there are about 45 parameters that you need to look at. Because when you first start, you will not know where the issue is.
Right.
Unless
right.
you talk to Elastic people.
Right.
So that was my first question. And
so
the second question.
Actually,
yeah.
monitoring was part of this. My session was around 40 minutes before. So I had to cut out everything. I removed the monitoring part. So we actually have a monitoring system where we built a plugin which collects the metrics, all kind of metrics, every possible metric, and then push it to another Elasticsearch cluster, and then we use that to monitor our system.
Okay. And the second part of the question was, as Elastic uses a mesh network,
mm-hmm.
you cannot scale it to multiple data centers.
That's right.
Yes.
So multi-data center is
yes.
not available yet,
yes.
but they are saying.
So that what happens is then you go to the same geolocation and then the network latency increases because the same data center has all the data. Then you can't scale the bandwidth of the network.
So basically you are talking about the active-active, right? Active-active or disaster recovery?
Not really. Like your main main cluster.
You want the
itself.
Same data to be available in some other geolocation,
no,
or
no.
you want the data to be distributed across geolocation?
No. So what happens is, if you start to grow the cluster in the same data center, your bandwidth goes on increasing, and beyond a limit, like you can't go on adding nodes in the same cluster.
Right.
So, for example, our data center had a 100 gig line, but that didn't support it later.
Right.
So, yeah. So, how did you scale that?
So, basically, there are two ways. One is multiple clusters, and then Elasticsearch, the recent version is supporting the multi. Sorry, Elasticsearch cluster. You can use that. By that way, you can push some of the data into one cluster and some other data into other cluster, but you can use a single query to query across all the clusters. By that way, you don't need to have need to add more nodes in a single cluster. Okay. There are tribe nodes you can try, but the problem is if index name is same, you have problem.
So the security gateway understanding similarly at the writer client here who can aggregate.
That we can do, but that's like writing another Elasticsearch.
Well, I think we'll need to take the other questions offline.
Okay.
We need to set up for the next speaker.